Hey, my name is Pablo. I'm a 3D concept and character artist with a passion for education. In this video, I'm gonna show you how I set up a project in Adobe Substance 3D Painter with a flexible, non-destructive workflow. The focus of this video is not on the texturing or painting side of things just yet, but rather on setting up a clean foundation so that we can work a little bit faster with the smart tools like the AutoCage and the Auto Updater. And I'm also gonna give you some tips about the path tool to create high details or hide information in your models with just texture information. All right, so here we are in Adobe Substance 3D Painter. Now, before we jump into any details, let me give you a quick look at the final scene that we are trying to build. It is a simple still life scene with lemons, sardines, and some ceramic pieces. And the idea is to go for a stylized painterly feel. The first thing I want to do is bake some mesh maps. And this step is a key part of the process because it sets the foundations for pretty much everything that comes next, like smart mask, high details, or any edge accents like wear and tear. Now, the model itself has some tricky spots. There are some overlapping areas and pieces that sit really close together. And this can make the baking process a little bit of a nightmare if you're doing everything manually. But there is a new feature that takes all the guesswork out of this step. So let's click on the Bake Mesh Maps button. In the baking window, I'm leaving most of the settings on default, and I just need to reference my high resolution version of this mesh. Once that is loaded, you'll see this ghost-like yellowish outline appear around the model, and that is basically the cage. This is like a buffer zone used during the baking process to project details from the high poly to the low poly. You can use this slider to adjust how tight or how loose that cage is. And the problem is that if it is too tight, you'll see some of these red zones. And these areas won't get baked properly, which results in some sort of gaps or weird artifacts on the surface. And this is where the AutoCage method becomes super useful. It is an adaptive mode that wraps the cage around your mesh automatically. It conforms to the volumes of the object, even in the tight corners like this. And it gives you a clean bake with just one click. Let's go ahead and switch to that mode. Hit bake, and we're done. After the baking process is done, we have a nice and clean result without any manual tweaking. Now, for the second part of this initial setup, I want to show you how to use external textures in a smart way. I got a PSD file with a photo of a sardine already matching the UV layout for this mesh. Nothing too fancy here, but I got a really cool workflow tip that will make this way more powerful. So let's start by dragging the PSD file into the asset library. Make sure this is set as a texture. And from the import dropdown, let's select the import as project. That way the texture becomes part of this project when we save it. All right, so now that this is part of our library, let's go ahead and create a new fill layer in the layer stack. And I'm gonna drag and drop the texture into the base color slot. That's it, the map perfectly fits into this mesh. Now here's where it gets interesting. Say I wanna adjust the saturation or tweak some of the contrast in this texture. Normally I would go back to Photoshop, export a new version, replace the file in Painter, load it up again, connect things, and that can be very tedious. But without the auto update feature, I don't need to do any of that. I just go ahead and open the PSD file in Photoshop, make any edits that I want, save the file, and Painter can refresh it for me. So let's go ahead and set that up. Back in Painter, go to the asset library and look for the small refresh icon at the bottom. You can click on that, and then you can check both of these boxes. One is to update the resources in the library itself, and the other one is to update that resource in all the instances of the project. So basically, whatever we used that texture before. So the texture will reload instantly everywhere that is being used. That is a serious time saver and definitely a smoother way to work. Now, before we wrap up, I want to show you one last thing. A simple but effective way to sculpt with texture. This is basically a way to add some extra surface details without modifying the model itself. So it would rely 100% on a texture map. So let's take this ceramic jug as an example, and it looks okay, but it's a little bit plain. We can add some stylized ridges or ornaments around the rim and that sort of stuff. So I'm going to start by creating a new fill layer, and I'm going to disable every single channel except the hide information. Now we can go ahead and add a black mask followed by a paint effect. Now I can select the path tool, and here's the trick. I'm just going to start clicking around the rim to draw a clean curve. And right now, this doesn't look like much. There's actually nothing happening. But the cool thing is that this pad is fully editable. So just so that you can see what we're actually doing, I'm going to increase the value of the hide information. There we go. And now we can go ahead and move the points, shape the curve, and adjust the entire design without needing to redo anything. It's non-destructive. Now, changing the placement of the curve points is not the only thing. We can open the stroke settings and increase the size and spacing of the instance that is used by the brush. Now we're starting to see kind of like the detail pop a little bit more. Now for the final touch, let's go ahead and add a smooth bevel effect. This filter allows you to soften and round the stroke. Instead of having a flat line with a bit of height, we end up with a nice, smooth ridge around the rim. Of course, you can fine-tune the curvature distance, the smoothness slider, and basically anything in this filter to get exactly the look that you want. And because this is non-destructive and procedural, I can change the look of this at any time. For example, I can go to the library and filter for my alphas, and I can just go ahead and drag and drop a brand new alpha into the stroke settings. This changes the alpha that is being applied to the stroke around the path, but we can go ahead and tweak the spacing, we can tweak the size, and essentially create a completely different ornament without losing the non-destructive flexibility. And that's a wrap for this setup. No painting yet, I know, but this video is all about preparing our scene for clean bakes, smart texture workflow, and flexible detailing tools. In another video, I'm gonna take this setup and I'm gonna show you how to texture this project to achieve that sort of stylized painterly look with some really cool finishes. Also, I'm gonna keep an eye on the comments of this video, so feel free to drop any questions or suggestions on things that you'd be interested to know more about. So that's a wrap for this video. No painting just yet, but as I said at the beginning, it's all about setting the foundations so that we can work a little bit faster. So now we have some clean bakes and everything in the project is ready to start the texturing process. In a following video, I'm gonna take this exact same project with all the setup that we've done, and I'm gonna show you how I textured my scene to create this stylized painterly look. See you there.